And recorded. All right. And I mean, I couldn't find my file, so I may have missed something in my preparation for the meeting, but I hope not. So welcome everyone who's here. Delighted to have you. This is exciting, our December meeting. I'm sorry we weren't able to make an in-person meeting happen this year, which is what we normally do for the, you know, for December and June, but I have my fingers crossed for June. So we will hope that that comes to be. And before we get to Frank Morgan's first 15, for those of you who didn't hear my yammerings or mutterings earlier, this is the month we traditionally announce who has been elected to the positions that are open on the board, to wit, vice president and recorder. Now, recorder is interesting because our own Frank Morgan of tonight's first 15 threw his hat in the ring, but I wasn't able to get anybody to sort of go and really make Lawrence's magic with nominations. So I would like to get the ball rolling by nominating, or by actually, are there any volunteers from the floor who would be interested in taking over the position of recorder? Dennis, do you want to say a few words about what it is that you do as recorder?
Actually, it's pretty easy. My main responsibility is just to record the minutes of the meetings. Usually, you know, the meeting starts at so and so time. You know, who presented the first 15? You know, what the main presentation was. Yeah, any old business or new business we discussed, and like I said, just simply taking down and then put it into a standard format, and then emailing it to the club president for them to review. That's it. I mean, the bylaws mention any additional tasks, but so far, really, it's just boiled down to recording the minutes of the meetings.
And thank you, Dennis. And of course, you know, the first half until we get to the business meeting is recorded to the cloud. So even if you miss a few minutes at the beginning or what have you, or you have to put a fire out in your kitchen, you can go back and check that recording in case you question it. So, I would like to nominate Frank Morgan for that position. And are there any other nominations from the floor or volunteers from the floor who would like to be nominated? That's what I thought. Do I have a second for my nomination for Frank?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
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 So,
aye, aye, aye.
Any opposed?
I'm not
any
a member.
Excuse me? Any abstentions? Congratulations, Frank. You're
up. Thank you.
And that is just wonderful. Thank you for throwing your hat in the ring. I really, really appreciate it. And I know the club will appreciate it too. It's important to have these records of our meetings. The bank likes to see that we run orderly meetings and that type of thing. So our next position is VP, and VP is in charge of basically lining up programs. Jim, would you like to say a few words about the job of VP?
Yes, sure. Just got to line up that speaker every month. And we have so many wonderful subject matter experts around here that people generally step forward and offer programs. And So that's not a big deal. And then you just have to correct that fine literary work every month of the meeting announcement and send it out. And that's about it.
Thank you, Jim. And I gather a lot of people help, you know, sort of give you suggestions and help you out with tracking down speakers, I believe.
Yeah, so Wendy.
Yes, Jack.
Yeah.
Jack French, big, found us lots of speakers this year.
Great. Someone said Wendy?
Yes, I did, Wendy. The other thing I wanted to bring up about the offices of VP and recorder is, as club officers, they also are tasked with filling in as MCs for the meeting should the club president is unable to attend. So it's
Usually we haven't in the past, you know, couple of years that we've been doing this, we haven't had any problems with kind of passing the baton on a temporary basis. So, but thank you for reminding us of that. So, VP, as you know, is a very important job. It's kind of what gives us grist for the mill for these meetings. And I wondered if there was anyone who thinks they would like to try their hand at this, who would like to sort of jump in and get to know the community better. A lot of you know the community a heck of a lot better than I do. So, and you don't have to be local to do this now because we are on Zoom.
And we already have programs planned out through March. So you got a 3-month grace period there.
Yeah, you've got some runway to get up to speed.
Yeah.
Any nominations or volunteers from the floor?
Wendy?
Yes, Bert.
Yeah. Frank and I are friends, so I think he'll take this in the spirit in which it's intended. I'm going to put you on the spot, Frank.
Yes.
You're an endless font of ideas, and you've already accepted one position. But given your organizational talents, I think you're capable of handling both the vice presidency and the recorder position. And I think you'd do an outstanding job.
Well, thank you, Bert.
So how do you feel about that, Frank? I mean, Bert really know. My copy of the bylaws is in a box somewhere. So I don't have my copy offhand, but I would imagine that if Bert brought this subject up, he is incredibly conversant with the bylaws. So this would not be in violation, or maybe it could be a bridge until someone else steps forward to be VP. I don't know. How do you feel, Frank?
I think that didn't Joni have two positions at one point?
Still does.
She still does. And she does through December of 2022. It streamlines things. How do you feel, Frank?
If people aren't going to get tired of hearing from me, I'd be willing to give it a shot.
All right. And I'm sure that Jim could backstop you a little bit if you needed it. Is that too big an assumption, Jim?
Oh, that's fine. That's fine. Because the only other alternative would be to figure out who's not here tonight and then nominate them and elect them.
I see a couple of faces on the screen that I know will help me get resources. And then we also, Joe Webb will work, I'm sure, with me the other fellows from Spurback. So hopefully, and of course, I would hope that the members of the club will also come forward to make presentations. That's also, John's done them, Jack's done them, Martin's done them. I've done a couple, I've got another one coming up. So, you know, hopefully there's interest within the membership to do them as well.
Yes, and I know that last month, Walden said he'd be happy to help with finding people and all. So I'm very grateful for that. Does Anyone else want to put their hat in the ring and make the race interesting? Well, then, Bert, would someone like to second Bert's nomination of Frank for VP?
I'll second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Anyone against? And Frank, you're not allowed to vote.
I appreciate the confidence.
I'm not a member. I didn't vote. This is Eric.
I'd like to mention that I think Edgar Russell should be in Frank's domain as for lining up speakers and programs, because Edgar is local in the metro area and he's done so much in terms of programs and writing and producing and speaking up, speaking out, all sorts of things. So I think Edgar should be willing to hopefully to work with Frank, and they could come up with, you know, discuss and come up with something. So Edgar, what do you think about that?
Well, thank you very much, Mark, for all the kind words. If I do come upon things or meet people that I think would be appropriate, I naturally will pass that on to Frank. And it's possible in the coming year that we may have an opportunity to do more plays. And so I'm open to that. I can't assist formally, but I certainly am continue to be very interested. And I will forward any names to Frank or others that I think might be good. So, but thank you again, Mark, for all the nice things you said about me.
That's lovely. Thank you. And I think that that's true of our membership in general. I know Jack French comes up with people. I mean, there are a bunch. So I think that Frank, you have been elected by acclamation to both the role of VP and recorder, which is, in my opinion, lovely. And now one quick matter. We have the Coelty Award that was not awarded last year because of the pandemic. Personally, I would like to nominate Martin Grams for his dedication and contributions to the club over the years. And I mean, he's always there when you really need him. And so I would like to put that nomination in for the Coelty Award. Does anyone else have ideas of people they think might fill the bill?
Before we talk about any others, Wendy, I'd like to second nomination for Martin as well, the Coelty Award recipient.
Great.
Thank you.
I'd like the third.
This looks like it's shaping up very nicely. Okay. Well, I think I'm getting the sense that the club would be very happy to have this award presented to Martin. And honestly, he probably should have won the year that he and I were running against each other. So I'm being perfectly honest here. It was only after the pandemic, when I could sort of institute the Zoom stuff, that I felt I had done something to justify having received that award over Martin. So without further ado,
I move the nominations be closed.
Yeah, thank you. As second for that.
Second.
All right, all in favor.
Aye.
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 Anyone at all opposed? I can't imagine they would be. Martin, congratulations. And I will figure out how to get your name on the plaque. I have it. I very carefully moved it into my apartment. I actually know where the plaque is. So I will get with, I think Dennis is the one who sometimes gets the little plaque updated and all that. We'll figure that out and find a way to do a meaningful presentation, both of the plaque and of the cup that goes along with the Coelty Award.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much. I can't think of a better person, honestly. Now I will return you to our regularly scheduled program and turn the meeting over to the ever popular Frank Morgan for our first 15. So let me just pass, let me see if I can do this on the iPad. Ah, I can, yay. Okay. Frank, you have co-hosting privileges, so the baton is passed to you. Everyone else, if you would please mute yourselves. Otherwise, your host will mute you in spite of what you choose.
Okay. Well, before I start, one thing I should mention is that I had reason to be in touch with Murray Horowitz, and he wished me to express his hello to everyone. So from Murray, hello. I chose the Magic Island for a presentation tonight. It's a kid's show, and I thought this time of the year, a kid's show would be something appropriate. It was a 15-minute serial. It was broadcast three nights a week. There are a total of 130 broadcasts, and all were transcribed, and all are available online and in excellent condition, so that if somebody likes to follow a children's serial, this is a good one. The show is written and produced by Percy Crandall, who also served as a cast member and the program's announcer. The show premiered in 1935 on Hollywood station KNX, and which was a CBS affiliate. Come back one. Now, I'm going to play the first episode of the series because it gives you the entire backstory. The primary characters are a Mrs. Patricia Grayson. She's played by Sally Creighton. Now, 14 years prior to this episode, she and her family were on a cruise and the ship sank. She was believed to be the lone survivor. However, she's clung to the hope that her infant daughter somehow survived. Captain Ted Bradford is ex-military. He's played by Will Reynolds. He's Patricia's business manager, her pilot, and also her boyfriend. Next character is a 16-year-old by the name of Jerry Hall, who's played by Tommy Carr. Jerry is a ham radio operator, and he's intercepted a message that indicates a young white girl is living on a mysterious island. So he inveigles his way onto a cruise to rescue her. Now, spoiler alert, because 14-year-old Joan Gregory has in fact survived and is living on this mysterious island. Joan is played by Rosa Barcello, and you won't hear her tonight because she hasn't been found yet. But if you are listening to the Cinnamon Bear, Rosa is Queen Melissa. Now, based on the message that Jerry intercepted, Mrs. Grayson directs Ted to prepare her yacht to sail to the island to see if the girl on the island is her daughter. This is a map of Euclidea, the name of the island. And for those who are on the phone, it's south of Los Angeles, a little southwest of Los Angeles. It's between the coast of Chile and New Zealand. And the island was built in the Pacific by scientists who are bent on world domination. Now, they're able to shroud the island with an intense fog to hide it, and they can even submerge it for up to 2 days if necessary to allow large ships to pass over it. Now, Joan is found by her mother, Captain Ted, and Jerry in episode 8. So that's pretty early on in the 130 series. So the next 122 episodes deal with their adventures surrounding the Magic Island. Now, in the course of the 130 episodes, there were a lot of scientific items covered. So the show had a strong educational component and is credited with a discussion of many scientific matters, some which were cutting edge. As you can see, kids learned how to convert fathoms into feet, to convert latitude and longitude to miles, respective power levels and ranges of mobile and stationary radio stations. Ham radio enthusiasts, they discussed the characteristics of magnetic light, sound, and infrared, ultraviolet, and radio waves, and a bunch of other things. Now, you get down to the last one on the list, thin film copper technology. All right. I looked it up and found a 7-page small print discussion. And beyond the fact that it's used in nanotechnology today, I don't understand another thing, but I acknowledge the science processing portion of my liberal arts brain has never been a strong point. So now we're going to go back to Euclidea, and I'm going to play for you episode 1 of Magic Island. Did it to me again this month. Okay, we'll get there. Here we go. It played when I warmed up. Let's try it again. There we go.
Wealthy and beautiful California woman, Mrs. Patricia Gregory, has spent 14 years searching the world over for her little daughter, Joan Gregory. 14 years ago, Mrs. Gregory, her husband, and baby daughter were shipwrecked in the South Pacific. Everyone on board was believed lost except Mrs. Gregory, but she has always felt that her little girl was also safe. This belief has caused Mrs. Gregory to offer a large reward for news of any young white girl found in the South Sea Islands who might prove to be her daughter. 14 years she has waited in vain, but now the story begins in Los Angeles. It is just 12 o'clock midnight. A police radio car is cruising near Mrs. Gregory's home.
R67. That's us. Let's hear it again.
Rolling car 14. Chester Place, near the street entrance. Investigative problem. North Chester Place, near Adams. That is all.
Cut him off. We'll have a look at us.
We're right in that block now.
Yeah. Slow down. This ought to be it.
I thought I saw somebody on that lawn there. That's a Gregory place, isn't it?
Yeah, there is something moving there. He's up the driveway, right behind him.
Where are you going, buddy?
Who wants to know?
Hold it right there and I'll show you. Hold it there, kid. I want to talk to you.
Hey, why don't you take that flashlight out of my eye so I can see who you are?
It's a lot more important that I see who you are. What are you doing here this time of night?
Well, suppose you tell me what you're doing here. And then maybe I'll... Oh, golly, Whiskers. I didn't see your uniform at first. The cops, huh?
Right, the cops. Now can you remember what you're doing in this driveway?
Well, I might live here.
You might, but you don't. We got a call on you as a prowler.
A prowler? I'm looking for a lady's house. That's not prowling, is it?
Well, depends on whether the lady wants you to be looking for her. This is Mrs. Gregory's house.
Honest? She's the one I'm looking for. Much obliged. I'll go and see her.
Hey, not so fast, buddy, not so fast. Do you know Mrs. Gregory?
No. But I've got some news for her. I heard about her little girl being lost in the South Seas on a magic island.
Oh,
and I...
So, her little girl's lost on a magic island, eh? And her mama don't know it, but you're going to tell her. Well, I'm Santa Claus, and I'm taking you to the North Pole with me. Come on.
Hey, let go of my arm.
Oh, you're
let
going
go.
To the station house. Come on.
No, I'm not. Help! Help!
Oh, the Mr. Gregory.
Will you shut up?
Somebody help. Hey, hey there, you.
Hey, now you're welcome up in the Gregory house.
I hope I woke somebody's up the whole coming. Block.
Take it easy, son. Now take it easy.
Yeah, yeah, there's no place to stay to fight.
Oh, well, we picked this kid up in your driveway on a prowler car.
I'm not a prowler, honest. I've got to see Mrs. Gregory right away.
Well, it isn't so easy to see Mrs. Gregory at midnight. What's your business here?
The kid's having a pipe dream about Mrs. Gregory's little girl floating around Australia on a magic island. I see that he don't bother you anymore. Come on, son.
Wait a minute. Hold it, officer. Did you say Mrs. Gregory's little girl?
You bet he did. But nobody's going to get a chance to laugh at me again. I'll tell my story to Mrs. Gregory, or not at all.
All right, officer. I'll be responsible for this boy. If he's not what he represents himself to be, I'll send for you again. My name's Bradford. I'm in charge of...
Oh, that's all right, sir. I know you, Captain Bradford. Call us if you want anything else. And let us know how the kid's magic island comes out.
I'm sure glad you came out, sir. He was going to take me to jail.
Well, if your story doesn't sound just right, you'll still get a chance to go. Come on up the house now. We'll meet Miss Gregory.
I know she'll want to hear my story, but I kind of hate to get her up at this time of night.
Never mind that. Miss Gregory and I were just going out. You go open the door there and go right in. I'll follow you. Go on in, kid.
But you ought to go in first.
I'll be the judge of what I ought to do. Go on in. Now, straight down the hall to that lighted arch.
What's going on, Tex? I thought I heard... Oh.
Are you Mrs. Gregory?
Yes, I'm Patricia Gregory.
Let's go in and sit down, Pat. I'm anxious to get a good look at this young fellow.
Say, Mrs. Gregory, your butler is mighty suspicious of me.
Butler?
I'm sorry, Tex, but you should see your face.
Butler? What makes you think I'm the butler?
Well, heck, nobody but a butler could act as suspicious of anybody as you do.
You're wrong, young man. Captain Bradford is in charge of my affairs. Manager of my estate, master of my yacht, pilot of my planes, and... But hadn't you better introduce yourself?
Yes, we'll ask a few questions now, son. You sit over there. Keep your hands in sight. Patricia, you stay near me.
Don't be absurd, Tex. What danger could there be? He's only a boy.
Yes, and Billy the Kid was only a boy when he had to put extra long handles on his guns to hold the Nazis.
Say, I've had about enough of this. I've got something to tell Mrs. Gregory. Do I get to tell her or don't I?
Of course you do. Keep quiet, Tex, and let the boy talk.
Thanks, Mrs. Gregory. Well, my name is Jerry. Jerry Hall. This afternoon, I picked up a radio message on my shortwave set on a band I'd never heard anything on before. Somebody was talking in funny broken English and said that an old sailor was very sick in a hospital somewhere near Honolulu. I guess he didn't say.
There it is again. The same thing.
Wait, Tex. Go on, Jerry.
Well, I guess this old sailor was so sick, he didn't know what happened to him. He was raving about how he'd escaped from a magic island in the South Seas and about a beautiful little white girl that was living there with some strange people. Well, I read all about your little girl being lost in the shipwreck when she was a baby, and I thought that, well, that is, gosh, I guess it sounds kind of foolish when I try to tell it.
No, it doesn't, Jerry. It isn't foolish at all. And Captain Bradford and I are leaving tonight, within half an hour, sailing on my yacht. And we're going to find out all about that old sailor and his story.
Well, I've been reading all about your little girl ever since I could read. Is it true that you were shipwrecked in the South Seas, just like the story say?
Yes, Jerry, it's all true. We were wrecked in the South Pacific when my little girl, Joan, was only a year old. Her father was lost, and of course, everyone else thinks my baby was also. But somehow, I've never quite given up hope that someday I'd find her.
And we've chased all over the world to see girls that people show to us to try and get some of the money Mrs. Gregory offered. But they never are the right ones.
Well, how could you tell your little girl? I mean, if it really was her.
Joan had a tiny birthmark, a little star-shaped scar on the back of her neck.
Joan. Gee, that's a pretty name. Joan. I'll bet she'd be pretty, too. Maybe almost as pretty as you are, Mrs. Gregory.
Thank you. There you are, Tex. Jerry's a bright boy.
Yes, his eyesight's all right. I'll say that. We've got to go. You see, kid, we heard the same thing on the shortwave that you did. We're sailing just as soon as we can get to the harbor.
Boy, that's slick. Will you take me with you?
Will we do what?
Take me along, will you? Oh, please.
Why, Jerry, we couldn't do that. We hardly know you. And you're so young, you can't be out of high school yet.
Well, I know my dad would let me go.
And I know a lot about boats and aeroplanes and radios and all that sort of stuff. And I'd work hard on the yacht. Oh, golly whiskers. How about it?
Not a chance. Out of the question.
I'm sorry, Jerry, but it just wouldn't do.
Beg your pardon, madam, but the car is at the door. Everything is quite ready. Baggage loaded.
Thank you, Johnson. We'll be out in a moment.
Very good, madam.
Now, Jerry, I'm afraid we'll have to say goodnight to you. It was sweet of you to come and tell us about your radio message. Won't you let me
hear? Oh, no, thanks, Mrs. Gregory. It was fun for me. You see, I've dreamed about finding you. Oh, well. Good night. I hope you have a lot of luck.
Thanks, Jerry. Good night.
Well, say, I was just thinking, if you could only let me go, I'd telephone my dad. He'd let me go when I tell him how nice you are, Mrs. Gregory.
Jerry, you're nice about this, and I would like to take you, but it wouldn't do, would it, Tex?
Sorry, kid, but it just isn't in the cards.
Boy, I'd sure like to see that magic island. The broadcast said there was something mysterious about it. How ships tried to sail up to it and couldn't, and it was big but invisible. He gave the exact position. It might be true.
Afraid not, Jerry. We'd sail through there on two steamer lanes. There isn't an island the size of a watermelon that isn't on the chart.
Well, I guess I'd better go now.
I'll see you to the door.
Are you afraid I'm going to take something?
No, but I'm going to take something. Something to remember you by. Open the door. Go ahead. Open it.
Gee whiz. That flashlight nearly blinded me.
Sorry, but we like to take pictures of the people who come to see us at midnight, and we like to know when they open our door, too.
But when I came in, I opened the door myself, and nothing happened.
And the flashlight shut off. Now go on, kid. Get out.
I'm sorry I bothered you, sir. Good night.
Dex, why were you so rough about sending him out?
I just got an idea. That boy's smart. He could have broadcast that message himself just to get a trip to the island with us.
I suppose so, but I do wish we could have taken him.
It might have been wise at that. And I could have kept an eye on him till we ran the story down.
Oh, well, forget it. Hurry, Tex. Johnson's waiting in the car. Jameson will lock up until we return. To the harbor, Johnson.
Then step on it.
Johnson. Oh, Johnson.
Yes, madam.
We're awfully crowded back here. Couldn't you find room up front for this roll of steamer rug?
I tried to put the roll up here, but he wouldn't have it.
Who wouldn't have what?
The young gentleman inside the rug, sir.
Huh? Say, Pat, there is somebody inside this roll.
And I can guess who it is.
I didn't think you'd find me till we got to the boat. And then maybe you'd take me with you.
I ought to wring your neck.
Now, take.
Oh, I know, Patricia, but
gee, I'm... Mrs. Gregory. Oh, now look, I'm plenty big enough to go with you. And we'll telephone my dad from the dock, huh?
How about it, Tex?
No.
Oh, now, Tex.
No. You got her on Miss Gregory, all right, Jerry, but you can't do that to me.
Oh, no, sir. I wouldn't try to get around you. I can see that nobody could do that. You're too smart. But I would like to sail with you. I could learn a lot from a man as smart as you are, Captain Bradford.
All right, you win, kid.
Golly whiskers. To the harbor, Johnson, and step on it.
Okay, so that is episode one of The Magic Island. I think it shows...
Can I ask a question?
Sure, certainly.
This was really nice. I wish I can hear the rest of the story, as they say, but... can you repeat the last two lines that the guy said, oh, nobody can get around you, you are too smart, and then I couldn't understand the rest.
Oh, okay. Well, the young man starts complimenting the captain about his abilities as a seaman and said that he could learn a lot from him. And Mrs. Gregory kind of chuckles, and they finally agree to take Jerry with...
Okay, so that's how he said, oh, you're too smart, nobody can get around you, but I would love to learn things from you. And that's how he persuaded him.
Exactly, exactly.
Okay, good. All right, thanks very much.
You're welcome.
That was really nice.
Let me go to the last graphic I have here, if I can get there. All right, well, Magic Island was clearly a children's program. It had mystery, adventure, and the triumph of good over evil. It also demonstrated the value of the relationships of family and friends. And, you know, I also found that the quality of the program that you just heard in terms of sound effects and the sound itself, well-preserved for 1935. So there's Magic Island.
Thank you very much, Frank. That was, I enjoyed it, but I'm a sucker for juvenile shows. So that is a great way to get us started. Did anyone else have any other questions for Frank?
Yes, I had a couple. First, I want to make a comment that I'm glad to see there's another fan of Magic Island out there. For those who haven't listened to it, it's a pretty good science fiction tale. I mean, some of the acting is a little bit difficult to get past, especially the golly whiskers acting of the guy who plays Jerry. But the story itself, as it goes through the, because it's serialized, it's a one complete story within 130 episodes, is actually very well done. So I do have two questions for you, Frank. One, you mentioned displaying some graphics like the island of Euclidia, but I didn't see any graphics come up. Did anyone else see the map or anything? So,
no.
Oh, you couldn't see the map?
No. Have shared your screen.
Oh, I don't think you shared your screen.
Yeah, well, let me go back to sharing the screen and I'll put that up there. Hopefully it'll show this time.
The other question I have is of the episodes that I have, none of them actually have an opening sequence, you know, like now presenting the Magic Island or whatever. They just start directly into the episode. Is that the case with the episodes you found? Or
yes. Yes. Okay. Can you see the map now?
No.
No.
I don't know why. Could you see the other graphics that I showed?
No, we didn't see any graphics.
Oh, goodness. That's half the fun of it. I'm not sure why.
Frank, when you share your screen, if you're doing like a PowerPoint or something,
yes,
when you share, it's going to ask what you want to share.
And all right.
If on the PowerPoint, it'll show it.
All right, let's go back and, because it only had a few, so, so share. Okay.
There you go. It's coming up.
Okay, great. Well, let me go back just real quickly then. The first one was just a...
That's great.
Yeah, an opening screen. So now you can see, and for those on the phone, again, it's a little southwest of Los Angeles. And if you can imagine South America, it's midway between, looks like halfway down the coast of Chile and the east coast of Australia. So that's where it sits. And then the other one I'd like to put up then is this list of scientific things that the show covered. And that's what Dennis mentioned, that there was a lot of science and educational parts to it. I'm sorry that it didn't show before. I didn't realize. Well, I'm learning, I'm still learning. So you can see early television technology, nautical navigation, the history of Greek mathematics, all of those things.
So although it was a radio show, I mean, it was never like a little television show eventually for teaching all of these things. So they taught all of these things over the radio.
Yes, they talked about those things. As I say, originally it was recorded in 1935, and because it was transcribed, it appeared in other cities through the early 40s, but there were only the 130 episodes. So even though it was still on in the early 1940s, all the shows had been done earlier.
Thank you so much, Frank. It gives me lots of grist for the mill.
Okay. Well, as I say, I found it. I liked it. And it's worth listening to a few episodes, particularly when they find the door. And I don't want to give away what happens. So Dennis knows, but
The teaser. Very well done.
Yeah, there we go.
Thank you.
So where do you find? I mean, do you go to YouTube and you listen to it, or how do you find those?
Okay, well, there's a website called zoot.com.
Z-O-O-T. How do you spell it?
Z-O-O-T.
Okay.
.com. And you can go through. They have tons of shows, and they're all free.
Wonderful.
Yeah, another website which also has them, where I found my episode, is archive.org. Once more, the episodes are free. You can either download them or just listen to them on the website.
Excellent suggestions. All right. Sally, have you warmed up your voice? Are you ready to take over as...
For the thing. And the lights.
All night, I think I've lost my...
Just kidding. I want to see how long I can get Jack to sweat.
Let me say, I'm going to ask everyone to mute. What I'm going to do is mute everyone, and then Sally, you can unmute. Because someone's talking on the phone, and their mic is live. Okay. So that's a little distracting, to say the least. And Sally doesn't always like to share the limelight. I mean, she's generally pretty good, but after a long week at school, maybe not. So Sally,
Wendy, it's Joan Leonard. My sister brought me in. I am so excited to be with you guys, and I'm so thrilled. I'm so anxious to hear the Joy Boys. So I just wanted to let you know that I'm here. She's here. She's Judy Rand.
Hi, everybody.
Hi. Thank you for getting Joan into the meeting, June.
I'd like to wish Miss Leonard a happy birthday next week. This is Derek.
Ah, wonderful.
Thank you, Derek. Thank you so much. I will be 82 on the 14th.
Wow. On December 14th, another Sagittarian. They're good people.
Absolutely.
All right. So I think we're going to move forward. Sally. Excuse me?
Sorry again. I'm sorry, but when we were talking about the zoot.com and some other suggestion, my phone rang and I couldn't hear anything anymore. I had to answer the phone. What was the other website for radio things that you mentioned?
Yes, the other website is archive.org.
Archive.org. Great.
Wonderful.
Thank you. Sorry about that.
No problem. Are we ready to pass the baton to our own intrepid Sally with the quiz? All right, Sally, take it away. You're in charge.
The power.
Had too much power this week. I somehow managed to get myself involved in running the Secret Snowflake, aka like Secret Santa event at school this week. So a lot of running things. This is my stalling. Children, you're supposed to be getting your pencils and your paper right now. This is your opportunity. Thank you. I see John is ready and Wendy is ready. I see that most of us have turned off our mics. Good job. Yes, good. Frank is getting his materials. Very nice. Excellent. The rest of you, what are you doing? Thank you. Thank you, Jack, for showing me you're prepared. Mark? I did not say this was an open notes quiz. Did I say this was an open notes quiz? You know when it is time to have your notes and when it is time to show what's in your brain. Show us what's in your brain, Mark. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Much better. All right. I think that's enough stalling time. I am going to launch the poll. As we know, I launched the poll. You are able to fill out your answers on the poll on the computer. You may also write them down because I will be reading them aloud to you. And then we can see the results and we'll get the results after our program. All right. I am going to launch the poll momentarily. Jack, I thought we were friends. I thought we were friends, Jack. Thank you, Wendy, for letting me know you can see the poll. Jack, we'll be speaking after class. I'll need to speak to you after class. Mm-hmm. Yes. Number one. Other than the Bible, the earliest book that spawned a radio series was David Harum, written by Edward Noyes Westcott. When was this novel first published? A, 1898. B, 1902. C, 1909. D, 1911. Other than the Bible, the earliest book that spawned a radio series was David Harum, written by E.N. Westcott. When was this novel first published? Number two. Stella Dallas, a 1923 novel by Olive Higgins Prouty, resulted in a Broadway play, two movies, and a radio series. The Hummerts began in 1938. Who played the title role for its 18 long years at the NBC radio microphone? A, Mary Jane Higby. B, Benaderet. C, Anne Elsner. D, Virginia Payne. Stella Dallas, a 1923 novel by OHP, resulted in a Broadway play, two movies, and a radio series. The Hummerts began in 1938. Who played the title role for its 18 long years at the NBC radio microphone? Number three. Mr. Keene, the main character in the unusual 1906 novel Tracer of Lost Persons, written by Robert Chambers, came to radio Chambers in 1937. Although the investigator in the book did, radio's Mr. Keene did not A. Find lovely women for rich bachelors to marry. B. Have an office full of several assistants. C. Use an incantation to bring an Egyptian mummy to life. D. All of the above. Mr. Keene, the main character in the unusual 1906 novel, Tracer of Lost Persons, came to radio in 1937. Though the investigator in the book did, radios Mr. Keene did not do what? Number four. Frederick Hugh Herbert, who created Meet Corliss Archer in a 1942 book of short stories, was unusual in that the author actually A. was an Austrian-born writer who attended college in London. B. began as a New York City news reporter with only a high school education. C. was a Harvard University chemistry professor. D. led the Navy efforts in the failed search for Amelia Earhart. Frederick Hugh Herbert, who created Meet Corliss Archer in a 1942 book of short stories, was unusual in that the author actually what? Number five. Charlie Chan was the creation of novelist Earl Dare Biggers in 1925. After several movies, he was brought to radio in 1932 and was on and off on NBC, ABC, and Mutual until 1947. Who was the last actor to play Chan at the microphone? A. Olin Soule. B. Carl Malden. C. Ed Begley. D. John Reiser. Who was the last actor to play Charlie Chan at the microphone? Number six. The Lone Wolf, first created in a 1914 novel, was far more popular in books and movies than he was as reformed thief Michael Lanyard on Mutual Radio. The novelist, Louis Joseph Vance, died tragically in 1933 under very strange circumstances. Which one? A. He was gored by a bull in Mexico City during an awards ceremony. B. He was shot by an unloaded gun while visiting a movie set. C. His parachute failed to open during a publicity jump in Ohio. D. He burned to death in his easy chair while drinking and smoking. How did the novelist die in 1933? Number 7. The evil genius of crime, Fu Manchu, arrived in the 1913 novel by Sax Rohmer. This Asian diabolical master criminal was pursued on radio on and off from 1929 to 1940 by which duo? A. Prairie Jim and Laramie Johnson. B. The Shadow and Margo Lane. C. Nayland Smith and Dr. James Petrie. You decide. D. Jane Sherlock and Peter Blossom. Who pursued the evil genius of crime from 1929 to 1940? Number 8. Novelist Eric Hudgens wrote, Mr. Blandings Builds His Dream House in 1946. It became a movie starring Cary Grant in 1948. Next, it was a radio series titled Mr. and Mrs. Blandings in 1951 with Grant as co-lead. Who played Mrs. Blandings at the mic? A. B. Betta Derrett. B. The third of Grant's five wives, Betsy Drake. C. Agnes Moorhead. D. Lorraine Tuttle. Who played Mrs. Blandings with Cary Grant? Number 9. Abby or Abby's Irish Rose by Ann Nichols was the script of an extremely successful Broadway play with 2,327 performances in the early 20s. Later, Nichols rewrote it as a popular novel. It was relatively short-lived when it became an NBC radio series. What years was it on the air? A, 1929 to 1931. B, 1933 to 1935. C, 1939 to 1941. D, 1942 to 1944. In what years did AB's Irish Rose stay on the air? Number 10. Mr. and Mrs. Cuget, The Record of a Happy Marriage, written by Isabel Scott Rorick, came out in 1940. Based on that novel, a CBS executive created a radio show in 1948, My Favorite Husband, for Lucille Ball. Later, that couple became the Coopers, and George's boss and wife became regulars in the series. Who played the wife of the boss? A, Kathy Lewis. B, B, Benaderet. C, Natalie Park. D, Florence Williams. Who played the wife of the boss on My Favorite Husband? Jack is going to need this bonus question because he is right now failing the class for his inappropriate use and overuse of the letter and sound B, of which there should never be that much B in one quiz. Therefore, Jack, you are going to need these bonus points. So you had best hope that your classmates have studied and are able to answer Jack's bonus question. I hope you didn't put your pencils down, children. Thank you for showing me your pencils. Because we have a bonus question tonight. And if it involves too many B's or too many names that have questionable pronunciation.
And it's a bonus poll. You can launch a second poll, Sally.
Oh, can I? I have that privilege. Oh, Jack. I'm going to end this poll by the time I count down from 30, 29, 28, 27, 26, 25, 24, 23, 22. If you are going to answer in this poll, I suggest you do it now. 22. 20. Wendy, if I stop this poll, will we be able to see the answers later? You believe so. All right. 15. 14. 13. 12. 11. 10. 9. 8. 7. 6. 5. 4. 3. 2. 1. Just kidding. Maybe. Ending poll. Launching other polls. Maybe. Oh, it's a drop down. Launching bonus poll. A CBS soap opera starring Julie Stevens and Bud Collier titled Kitty Foyle was derived from the 1939 novel of the same name written by Christopher Morley. The novel's opening line was, A, call me Ishmael. B, it is a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a good fortune must be in want of a wife. C, what a grand guy. Sometimes he used to sneak a slug of whiskey in the forenoon against doctor's orders. D. It was the best of times. It was the worst of times. What was the opening line of the novel Kitty Foyle? I will allow you 6 more seconds to complete this poll. Poll ending. Ooh. I can see the results of both of them. Ooh, okay. All right, Jack.
Thank you, Sally.
We will see. We will see.
Right. All right. So now I will give hosting privileges.
Miss Wendy? Miss Wendy?
Yes.
May I speak?
Absolutely.
All right. I'd like to take a minute to mention the two publications of our club, and they've been in existence for many years. First is the universally known Radio Recall, which began years ago and was perhaps carried for many years by Jack French, and now it's in the good hands of Bob Cockrum. And it seems to be on an even keel. And in the this month's issue, Bob actually wrote a very nice piece about the history of Lux Radio Theater
and the different locations and the fame that it enjoyed. The other one, Gather Around the Radio, which is my contribution. January, I will be writing it again, and January begins 18 years that I have been putting it together, and you've all seen the different formats and the different styles. And January 2005 was when I first put out that newsletter, and it was like a sunshine. It was like a sunshine letter back then, and so I've taken it through different formats. Most of the people that I see on this screen have contributed to Gather Around the Radio. Most recent was Jack French, when we put out a piece about the history of the pop song Blue Moon. So I'd like to just say how pleased I am that so many people have contributed, and put out a new call for contributions to begin the new year. And so that about wraps it up. Beginning my 18th year, I'd like to put out a call to everyone to write stuff up and send it in. And I'll put it in my own format. Sometimes it's interview format, and sometimes it's just an essay by one or the other of you. So I'd like to hope that the Dusty Courier pouch will be full from each month from now on. So thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Mark. I was going to ask you in the business part of the meeting to, but you taking care of it now. So we will go on to the main program, because what we're doing is doing the business at the end of the meeting these days. But this is great. And you reached more people doing it this way. So thank you. But now I would like to pass the baton to John Abbott, who is going to give us our main program. And it's about the Joy Boys. So take it away, John.
Okay, let's see if I can do this here. I know I need to click that. And I'm going to click on that. And everybody should see my opening screen there. Hopefully, I got a thumb up from some Wendy. So tonight, live and in person, we're going to discuss the Joy Boys. Washington, D.C.'s contribution, Washington, D.C. radio contribution to culture, maybe? We'll find out. The program is not really one that you would consider in the mainline old-time radio programs. But it started out in the mid-50s when old-time radio was still there and outlived, you know, a lot of the classic programs. And it was hosted by two Washingtonians, Ed Walker and Willard Scott. And if you were cruising around the radio dial during the period when they were on, no doubt you would hear this.
We are the Joy Boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro. We are the Joy Boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro.
Okay, everybody hear that? Okay, the theme was the Billboard March, written in 1869. The lyrics came from the Capital Radio Enthusiasts Institute in Washington, where engineers trained to run and work on radio stations. And although both Ed and Willard were on many different programs over the years, we're just going to focus on one, and that is the Joy Boys. Now, Ed Walker was born in 1932, Forest, Illinois. And there we go. I need to get that out of the way. He was blind from birth. And he said in an interview one time that he used the radio the same way other kids would use comic books. He attended the University School for the Blind in Baltimore and ultimately entered American University as its first blind student. While at AU, he helped launch WAMU-FAM, the campus radio station. And then he ended up working on other Washington area radio and TV stations, including WJLA-TV, News Channel 8. And we all know that for 25 years, he hosted the big broadcast. In 2009, he was elected to the National Radio Hall of Fame as a local or regional pioneer. Sadly, Ed died in 2015. Just 3 hours after recording his last big broadcast show from his hospital room. I seem to have lost control of my thingy here. Okay, Walter Scott was born in 1934 in Alexandria. He's a local boy. He worked at WRCAM as a page. Then he went to American universities, which is where he met Ed Walker. Now, he worked with Ed from 1955 until 1972 with a 2-year hiatus in the U.S. Navy. He also appeared as a local weatherman. He appeared as Bozo the Clown after the Joy Boys ended. He was a narrator for the NASA program, The Space Story. Most people recognize Willard as the weatherman on the Today Show. Willard retired for real in 2015 and died in September of this year. Okay, let's talk a little bit about the program. When you listen to the Joy Boys program, there were two things which were absolutely certain. Program would start, the program would end. In between those two events, almost anything was possible. Now, there was the usual radio fare, music, news, commercials, on-air guests. But the nice thing about the Joy Boys was that there was a lot of fun. Sometimes in listening to it, there was a little bit too much fun. You almost got the feeling that they were doing the program for themselves. And if anybody else listened, oh well. The program, as I said, started in 1952 as the program Two at One. Obviously, two hosts on at one in the afternoon. When Willard got back from the Navy, the Joy Boys returned as a 2-hour program in the drive time slot, no doubt contributing to a higher level of automobile accidents. 1960 to 61, the program was kind of trimmed back a little bit to a half hour program. But at the same point in time, the program was being broadcast by the AFRTS. 1962, even more cuts. To once a week as the WRC showcase. However, in 1963, the program becomes NBC Night Watch, airing from 8 p.m. until midnight. And this is when I listened to the Joy Boys. Some of the best time I had listening to the radio was listening to the Joy Boys. Things didn't last forever on WRC. In 1972, the Joy Boys was dropped. So they just moved down the street to WWDC and continued to entertain the Washington area until 1974, when the program finally ended. Now, one of the highlights of the Joy Boys were program spoofs. Some of these might sound familiar. As the Worm Turns, The Yellow Ghost, Robin Hood of Rock Creek Park, Stella Bear, WWVO, and then later on WWPU, Betty Crockett, Lucille O'Neill, The Lone Ranger, Master Puss Theater, The Sodbuster, Miss Janitor, and Memos from Management. And there were a lot of others, but these are the major ones. And the ones I've highlighted here are the ones that we're going to listen to tonight. A couple of them bear some interesting side points. The Sodbuster was really a takeoff on Gunsmoke, and Miss Janitor was a takeoff on Miss Monitor. Those who remember listening to Monitor Radio, there was a sultry voiced young lady there who would read the weather forecasts. Miss Janitor, who knows what she won? One episode, she actually just listed all scores. Didn't say who the teams were, just listed the scores. So we'll get to some of these a little bit later on. One of the things also, since WRC was a commercial radio station, the Joy Boys had sponsors. And some commercials were read straight as the advertising department presented them. Some of them were audio commercials, so they didn't have too much choice in the matter. But some commercials, well, the Joy Boys had their own little special take on some of these. In an interview, Ed Walker once noted that some clients were really upset when Ed and Willard did not have fun with their ads. So they had quite a loyal following, not only amongst listeners, but amongst the sponsors also. So let's get into the program samples, which is where you get to listen, I get to stop talking, and the program definitely goes on the upswing. The first program that we will listen to is As the Worm Turns. As the title suggests, it's a parody of As the World Turns, which was a long-running TV soap opera that ran from 1956 to 2010.
And now, the continuing true-to-life story, As the Worm Turns, the story of life today in a big city hospital, and all brought you by Scoff No More, the miracle plastic product of the space age to spray your little children to protect them from other little children. It's early afternoon as our story opens in Big City Hospital today. We find ourselves outside of the office of the highly respected throat surgeon, Dr. Clayton Jackson Durante. Dr. Durante was awakened in the middle of the night by a telephone call from a top 40 radio station where the all-night disc jockey had some pleading moments with the doctor. The doctor, being true to the medical profession, told him to call back in the morning, which he did. Outside the door now, pacing nervously, fiddling with his cigarette pack, he nervously lights his cigarette. There's a moment as he puffs, thinking to himself, what could this possibly be? Finally, the doctor knocks on the door.
I'm sorry. Let me try it again, all right?
We haven't been here for months.
No,
go ahead.
Old habits are hard to break.
Doctor knocks on the door. Forget it. Come on in. And the young DJ, Pearly White, speaks.
Doc?
Yeah, what is it, Junior?
Dr. Durante?
Yeah, that's me, Clayton Jackson Durante.
Doc?
Come on in and sit down, Junior.
I am sitting down.
Oops. I'm sorry. I clicked on the wrong thing there. Let's see if we can get this started again. Well.
And now, the continuing true-to-life story, As the Worm Turns, the story of life today in a big city hospital, and all brought to you by Scoff No More, the miracle plastic product of the space age to spray your little children to protect them from other little children. It's early afternoon as our story opens in Big City Hospital today. We find ourselves outside of the office of the highly respected throat surgeon, Dr. Clayton Jackson Durante. Dr. Durante was awakened in the middle of the night by a telephone call from a top 40 radio station where the all-night disc jockey had some pleading moments with the doctor. The doctor, being true to the medical profession, told him to call back in the morning, which he did. Outside the door now, pacing nervously, fiddling with his cigarette pack, he nervously lights his cigarette. There's a moment as he puffs, thinking to himself, what could this possibly be? Finally, the doctor knocks on the door.
I'm sorry. Let me try it again, all right?
We haven't been here for months. Go ahead.
Old habits are hard to break.
Doctor knocks on the door. Forget it. Come on in. And the young DJ, Pearly White, speaks.
Doc?
Yeah, what is it, Junior?
Dr. Durante?
Yeah, that's me, Clayton Jackson Durante.
Doc?
Come on in and sit down, Junior.
I am sitting down.
You're just short, huh, kid?
I'm a short jock.
I've got a million of them,
Doc,
Stop that. Try to get over that, will you, kid?
I needed that. I got something that's rather personal that happened to me at the studio last week, and I first noticed it after I'd had a date with a switchboard operator.
Let me ask you something, kid. Does she have a sister?
Well, what have we here? What happened to the young top 40 disc jockey after he had his date with the switchboard operator? You won't want to miss the next gripping episode, As the Worm Turns, 1 hour from now, when you'll hear the young DJ, Pearly White, speak to Dr. Durante and say... Apparently, the young man is speechless. Be listening 1 hour from now when Scuff No More once more brings you The Worm Turns, written for radio by Denise on Damon De Valero, produced by Tarnal A.O.T. Thomas, a Damon Del Tandel production, and comes to you from Washington. Till 3:15.
Ta-ta!
Sorry about that little mix-up there. I've got a new setup here, and I accidentally hit the wrong button and went to the next one, Lucille O'Neill. This is a parody of various advice programs that were on the air, both TV, radio, in the newspaper, and whatnot. But with the Joy Boys give it their special little twist.
And now it's time for radio's golden moment. Dear Lucille, the question lady, lecturer, doctor of psychology, and Potomac playgirl in the award-winning series Dear Lucille, where you, the listeners, send Lucille your problems. Now, please keep in mind that Lucille does not answer questions of political, medical, religious, analytical, technological, hypothetical, numerical, or extremely intimately personal nature. Dear Lucille is brought to you for the 24th year now by Madame Mammy Uch's Calming Tea, the tea from the Orient, made by Orientals for Orientals. Problems. Remember, good old Madame Mammy Uch's tea. Look for the big red box with the sleeping dragon on the front, and you've got Madame Mammy Uch where you want her.
Absolutely.
And now here's Dear Lucille.
Thank you, Willard Scott.
First of all, Lucille, a lady from Wheaton writes, Lucille, my aunt is a lovely person, and both Clifford and I, that's my husband, and the kids love to visit her. She is an older woman, and our visits seem to mean so much to her. She has this lovely little cottage in the suburbs, and the kids have a wonderful time. One problem, Lucille, her dog Nero is a 145-pound Doberman, and he's very possessive about Aunt Hilda. As soon as the car drives up, he leaps off the porch and attacks the car. Twice last month, he bit holes in Clifford's new Michelins.
Good heavens. That's terrible.
You ought to see Clifford. Just last week, when I was giving Hilda a friendly peck on the cheek, Nero, the Doberman, tore my pantsuit off and pinned me to the floor for 40 minutes. Hilda just laughs and says he's such an affectionate little thing. 2 days ago, I stopped by to take Hilda some homemade soup, and Timmy, he's our youngest, disappeared for a moment. I looked out back into the woods, and Nero had Timmy in his mouth and was carrying him off into the woods. You must help me. Give us some advice as to what I can either say or do that will let Hilda know something has to be done about Nero, or we just can't keep visiting her. Signed, Down Boy.
Dear Down Boy, I would suggest, first of all, you buy Nero some dark glasses, have a little suit made for him, and pass him off as one of our salesmen. He's got about as much manners, and I think he'd do very well. He might come home with a couple of new accounts.
Oh, yes. Okay, Lucille, nice one. Good O, as we say, Lucille.
Or teach him to play the violin and he could fiddle.
While Rome burns.
That's right.
Oh, dear Lucille, it's brought to you by for the 25th year now, consecutively.
This may be it.
You may have blown the whole quarter of a century here, Lucille. Brought to you by Madame Mamiuch's Calming Tea. The calming tea made in the Orient by Orientals for Oriental problems. Mm. Remember, look for Madame Mamiuch with the big red box and the sleeping... with the sleeping dragon on the front. And you've got Madame Mamiuch where you want.
I'm dragging a little myself.
So long, dragon lady.
Give me a cup of that jazz.
Transcribe.
As you can tell, maintaining composure on the radio was not necessarily a requirement. The next program that we're going to listen to is Master Puss Theater, obviously a parody of Masterpiece Theater, which at the time was aired by Alastair Cook. In the early 70s, PBS ran the BBC production of The Six Wives of Henry VIII. And was rebroadcast again on CBS 1971. So, you know, far be it from the Joy Boys to ignore history, here's Master Puss Theater.
This station, in cooperation with Public Service Broadcasting, presents the award-winning series Master Puss Theater, made possible by a grant from the Siamese Cat Lovers of the World. I am Alastair Cook. I am exciting, I am gorgeous, and I am perfect as a host for this highly educative program. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the first part in our series of six parts, The Six Wives of Henry VIII. As we all know, Henry VIII was a big man. He was big in his lust for life. He was big in his physical stature. He was big in his appetite. And, as would indicate by his six wives, he had other habits. Henry VIII, not really a bad sort. Henry VIII, more of a spirited, spoiled child who never really grew up. As our story opens today, the first story including the life of his first wife, Catherine of Aragon. And as we all know, with his divorce, he not only severed his marital relationship, but also broke relations with Rome. And now, part one of the six wives of Henry VIII, Catherine of Aragon. The scene is the court.
Yes, who is it?
My lord! My lord, it's your wife, the Queen Catherine of Aragon! She wishes to speak to you, sir.
Very good. Tell her to enter.
Very good, sir. Her Highness, the Royal Queen of England, Catherine of Aragon.
I know that. I'm married to her, you idiot. Come in, Catherine.
It's just the way we did it at rehearsals.
Yes, I know. Catherine, would you close the door, please?
You're out of the same way, your lordship.
Matter of great urgency distresses me much.
Get on with it. I got a garden party going down in the Rose Room.
We've always got a garden party or some social event, you see.
You're a fat slob. Have you ever looked at yourself? Take a good look at yourself.
This is off the point of the issue.
Well, go ahead.
We've been married for years, and I am devoted to you. You know that. You know that I loved you. I've looked at no other woman since you and I have been together. Buddy. But you have not given me a son.
I want a son. I gave you Mary Tudor. What do you want?
I want a son.
Well, why don't you call Hertz? I can't do anything about it. That's not my problem.
I've thought it over, Catherine, and I know it will not sit easy with Rome. The only alternative I have is for us to sever our relationship.
You mean you want a divorce? Big deal.
Yes, I want a divorce.
You think it's a big deal? You had the guy come in. His Excellency the King wants to see. I heard all that.
It's all protocol.
I knew you were going to ask me for a divorce, and I've been planning for it.
You
get your divorce. Here, the papers are already signed.
Just a moment.
Wait till Rome hears about this, Big Daddy. You haven't seen the end of it all.
You're too anxious to have me sign. Is there someone else?
Yes, there's someone else.
There is.
There's a musician and the court players.
Irresponsible musician. Bah! What can he give you?
Been seeing each other under the balcony outside of the castle for the...
Where is this oaf? I'd like to meet him.
I'll be glad to show him to you. Come on in here. Come on inside, sweetheart.
Well, a wonderful king. Good heavens, not him.
It's Lawrence, Sir Lawrence of Belk. And Sir Lawrence and I are going to go to the New World in California. And Larry's going to open up a dance hall.
That's right, Your Highness. I really love this woman. She does the polka exceedingly well. We work so well together, I've changed her name to Norma Zimmer. She'll be the lovely champagne lady, and we've named the ballroom after her.
You mean the Catherine?
No, the Aragon Ballroom. Let's go, Catherine. A one and a two.
So long, sire.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, part one of Masterpiece Theatre. Henry VIII and his first wife, Catherine of Aragon, having formed the Aragon Ballroom, she left the king. Tomorrow, you certainly will be interested in hearing about Anne Boleyn. The king lost his heart to her, and she lost her head to him. Until then, Alistair Crook, good day.
Never let it be said that the Joy Boys did not present a different take on history. The Lone Ranger is our next program. This clip that we're going to play tonight is off of a WAMU CD called Remembering the Joy Boys, which was a pledge gift. Hence the introduction by Ed and Willard. Obviously, this is a spoof of The Lone Ranger.
The Lone Ranger was our next one, and The Lone Ranger, we called it The Lone Arranger, I think.
Yeah, because that's a play on words about a guy had a savings and loan, which are defunct now, they didn't even have them anymore, who would loan you money, and he would be the guy who arranged the loan. The Lone
Arranger. That's very good.
That stinks. I mean, that's no wonder you're not on the air anymore.
Anyway, here is the Lone Ranger and Pronto, his faithful Indian companion.
That's a play on words. The actual Indian name was Tonto. Did I explain that?
Oh, is that?
That's the same guy who wrote the Lone Ranger.
Yes, that's right. Anyway, they trade in their horses for a sports car.
General Thrills, makers of Feeties, the greatest name in stretch socks, brings you another exciting episode of the Lone Ranger, the daring and resourceful masked rider of the plains who brought with him law, justice, and the American way of life.
As our story opens, we find the daring and resourceful masked rider of the plains and his faithful Indian companion standing outside of their penthouse apartment down on 14th Street, where the masked rider says to Tonto,
Tonto, I have news for you.
What you do now, fat man?
That's Mask Man. Pronto, I have traded. Are you all right, Pronto?
Big party last night. Fat man, me got swell head.
Yes. Pronto, I have traded in Silver and Scout and bought a new Thunderbolt sports car.
That's plenty bad, fat man. Why you do that?
Because, Pronto, I thought we ought to be modern, and we cannot track down the criminals as fast on horseback as we can in this superb sports car. Look at it over here.
It make plenty good sense.
Now look. Just hop in there, Pronto.
Got wire wheels, fat man.
It has everything.
Steady, big fellow.
No, this is not a horse.
How many horse in car, Kimosabe?
I don't know, several hundred. This is a very powerful sports car. Now, if I can just find
What mean Coventry, Kimosabe?
I haven't read the book of instructions yet. Let's see if I can find the key switch here.
While the daring and resourceful masked rider of the plains and his faithful Indian companion, Pronto, are looking for the key switch to insert the key to start the car. The Lone Ranger says to Pronto,
I found it, Pronto. Here's the ignition. Now then, we're ready to take a little joyride in our new sports car.
All you right. know how drive car, fat man.
Certainly, Pronto. All right.
Get him up, Thunderbolt.
Listen.
Here we go, Pronto. Shift gears there.
You jerk neck, fat man, and take off.
Well, that's the way it goes, Pronto.
Shift gear, fat man. My head still back on
just a moment
continental
now,
kit.
Let me figure out how to shift the gears on this sports car.
What here. That round thing over there by you, fat man?
I'm not quite sure, Pronto. It said something in the instruction book about a steering wheel, but I'm not familiar with that, I think.
I see, page 42, that steering wheel. Not too good idea, fat man. You hook up reins to hood.
That's right, Pronto.
I don't think you're going to be able to steer the car.
Pronto, what is that looming up in the distance?
It looked like a wall to
I can't seem to steer
nursery,
the car away from the
man.
Wall, Pronto. I think we're going to have an accident. Look out! Brace yourself! Pronto, are you all right? Pronto, I think I should have used the steering wheel instead of hooking the reins onto the hood.
Lone Ranger is a copywritten feature of General Thrills, also by Campbell Trimble, Mendel Gildersleeve. One of Lone Rangers played by Fred Fate. Your announcer is Grace Bomb.
The next spoof that we're going to listen to is Robin Hood of Rock Creek Park. For those who are not familiar with the Washington, D.C. area, Rock Creek Park really bisects the western part of Washington, running from the Potomac all the way up through to the Maryland border. And it's a really nice place. You can go to the National Zoo and see all the wildlife. You ride your bicycle on the weekends because they close off the roads, or you can just relax, especially when you're stuck in rush hour traffic. Now, from 1955 to 1959, the English program, The Adventures of Robin Hood, was on the air. And so that is the source of this spoof.
And now the National Broadcasting Company brings you The Adventures of Robin Hood of Rock Creek Park.
Robin Hood, riding through the glen. Robin Hood, with his band of men. Steered by the bad, loved by the good. Robin Hood.
Ben Bobby, the greatest name in Bobby Pins, brings you the adventures of Robin Hood of Rock Creek Park. Today's exciting story is entitled, Robin Hood and His Men Discover Culture. As our story opens, we find ourselves riding through the thicket outside of Rock Creek Park.
Well, there's a friend, Curly, Robin, a friend,
ho, dismount, men. Little John, when are you going to learn to dismount from your horse?
I told my horse to quit riding me there. We've got to learn this thing the right way.
I do believe it. Now, men, I've called you all together here because we're going to pay a visit to the public library. Now, men, it's about time that we, the merry band of men, I'm going to get a book on reading while I'm here. We need culture. Right, Little John?
Hi, Robin. We need culture.
Right, Friar Tuck?
Hi, Robin. I'm a vulture for culture.
Hi, Robin. I'm a...
I didn't ask you yet, Alan Adale.
Keep your mouth shut.
Now, men, one thing you must remember. This is a library. People are reading and studying in here.
Hi, Robin.
You must be quiet at all times. We talk in a whisper.
Can I bring my horse in with me, Robin?
Don't be silly. Of course not.
Sorry, Trigger.
Now, come to the door of the library, gentlemen.
Hi, Robin.
Now remember to be quiet at all times. I will just open the door and we'll walk in. Shh. The librarian is over there. I'll ask her for the book.
I look at my foot, it's a guy with...
Shh.
sir, you're going to have to be quiet. This is a public library.
Look at that funny-looking guy over there, Robin, sitting there reading the racing form.
No, that's
the Batman. He's been out of work now for about 7 years.
I don't think so. Miss, I'm looking for a volume of the Prehistoric Encyclopedia.
I told you, sir, you're going to have to be quiet. This is a public library.
I'm sorry, Robin. I haven't been smoking but about another 6 months ago, and I burned myself.
Little John, would you please be quiet?
Now then. You really need that book, Robin?
Sir, if you don't be quiet, I'm going to have to ask all of you and your band of men to leave this library.
Robin.
Yeah, yes.
I didn't see her in rehearsal. Who's that?
That's the librarian.
Oh.
We needed an extra at the last
moment.
Who
read her part during rehearsal?
I don't know. I think it was Little John. Well, I see that we're not going to get anywhere here.
Sorry, sir, but we don't have the book you asked for.
You're not the librarian, Little John. Get from behind that counter. What are you doing?
Oh. I'm sorry, sir. We don't have the book you wished for. That's my line.
Hey, who is that girl?
If you don't mind, I'd appreciate it if you all kindly leave. You're making entirely too much noise in this library.
All right, Robin,
let's go. Come on, ma'am. Sorry, madam. Here.
Robin, before we get our horses and ride out of here, because it's 30 seconds before the end of the show, I have a question I'd like to ask you.
Yes?
What books were we going after and why do we need the books?
Some prehistoric volumes of an encyclopedia I once read, and they're just the exact thickness for propping up the short legs of our pool table men. We've got to have those books or else we cannot shoot pool.
Hi, Robin. Let's go. Robin the friend.
This has been a Hood Roy production.
Okay, the next program that we're going to hear murdered on the air was Stella Bear. And this is obviously a parody of the soap opera Stella Dallas, which was on the radio from 1937 to 1955.
And now... Once again, King Kong Birdseed, the greatest name in birdseed, the only birdseed that makes your parakeet look like an ape, sound like a lion, and gentle as a bear, brings you the heartwarming story of just plain Stella Bear and her fight for love and happiness, starring the gifted stage and screen star, Margaret Hartburn, in the title role of Stella Bear, kindly old lady. It is early afternoon as our story opens. We find Mama Bear and Papa Bear in the kitchen and at the dining room, too, preparing a big dinner for some neighbors who are dropping in for an evening supper. Young Herbert is standing by, 38-year-old wealthy playboy son, to run an errand for Mama Bear as Papa Bear calls to Herbert and says,
Herbert, come here.
Oh, yeah, what do you want, Pop? Boy, that sure is a nice-looking table there, Ma. You got all the doodads and the silver and the china and the Japanese and everything else on the table there.
Thank you very much, Herbert. Now, you do what your dad says here and listen to him.
Okay, what do you want me to do?
Well, Herbert, your Ma thought it would be nice to have some mint in the iced tea. Now, there's some mint growing out there in the garden. Would you like to run out and get it for us?
Oh, sure. I'll be right back in the jiffy.
You are a good boy, Herbert.
What's that?
You're a good boy.
Thank you, Ma.
He is a good boy, Papa Bear.
He is a good boy, isn't he, Ma? How many people we got coming for dinner tonight?
Just six. Well, aren't you a good fellow?
Oh, boy, this is the nicest mint you ever saw. Just dropped them right in the glass there.
Boy,
Herbert. That's your smell that. That
wait
is...
a minute, Herbert, don't touch that
What's
stuff.
What's the
matter? That's poison ivy, Herbert.
You know something, Ma? I think we got scissors in our backyard.
Herbert, take that out of here. You brought poison ivy from the backyard.
Oh, that ain't no poison ivy, Ma. That's mint. I know. It's something terrible.
Ooh. Get the calamine. I think Herbert's in for the evening. Play the theme.
Oh, that scratches. Ooh-wee. Somebody do something.
Don't touch me with you, little boy.
Let's say
you
can't.
King Kong Poison Birds has brought you another exciting episode of Just Plain Stella Bear, kindly old lady starring Margaret Hartburn in the title role. Based on the book Not Enough Soon Enough by Claudia Clyde, adapted for radio by Geraldine Fitzgeraldine. This has been a Sherman D. Tank production.
Only hurts when I scratch.
All right, that gives you an entirely different perspective on hosting a dinner party. The next segment that we're going to listen to is one of my personal favorites. They did a series of takeoffs on the West Virginia Jamboree, which was aired on WWVA. They called it WWVO initially, until management said, you know, WWVO in Seagram's, West Virginia, that's just too close to advertising alcohol on the air. We can't have that. So they changed it to WWPU in Sorghum's, West Virginia. So let's take a listen.
Well, bless your pea-picking hearts out there in the land, wherever it happens to be, radio or TV. The all-night country music picking and singing jamboree from the country music capital of the world, WWVO in Seagram's, West Virginia. It's your old coffee-drinking night owl, Hootmore, my brother Mo. Say hi to the folks out there, no?
Hi to the folks out there, no, and bless your harsh livers, Ad Noise. My goodness, Mr. Engineer, come here. We love everybody.
Come on now, come on now. It's hot outside. Leave it.
Man, smells like old spouse. Or spice.
Spice, I
want to thank the chief down at the firehouse there and all the boys for the card game last night. Chief Millard Fillmore served a wonderful dish his lovely wife Maynard made.
Maynard?
We've always wondered about both of them.
Had a good time. It was super, Chief.
Super, Chief. Yes, I never had raccoon ragu before. It was delicious.
Dynamite,
but we're just pleased as punch to have all the fire boys listen to us here at WWVO. And keep them fires going, boys. You get your pay anyway.
We got us a wonderful sponsor this afternoon. I know you're going to want to try out for yourselves. Leadbetters, Lord of mercy, have mercy upon us. How much more can we take? Low-down, good deals on catch them yourself country meals. That's from Empty Gut, North Carolina.
Friends, I know inflation has taken its toll on your food budget.
Yes, it has.
And that's why Leadbetters has beat the better prices.
Mm-hmm.
Mating habits of edible critters in the area can now be yours in this wonderful booklet prepared by Leadbetter. You know, when an animal is mating, he's got his mind on other things, and that means he's a little easier to catch.
Yeah.
Also, friends, we have over 50,000 groundhog holes mapped out in the metropolitan area, all marked on one handy-to-read map. You can catch them while they're running. Recipes for such rural gastronomic treats as
coon dish casserole, possum burgers, rabbit rarebit, squirrel soup, hummingbird tongue pie, and many, many more.
Send $2.98 to
down the hatch, WWVO, Seagram's, West Virginia.
Young, I used to help my old man off the back porch step up to a spot on a piney wood hill, and there he'd make me run the still.
But now Jimmy drinks corn and no one cares. Jimmy drinks corn and no one cares. On the still after all these years, 'cause Pappy's gone away.
So that's about all the time we have for this afternoon, or is it this evening, on the all-night country music picking and singing jamboree. Where's Lazy Luther appearing?
Lazy Luther and the Sugarloaf Mountain Boys on Monday will be at the Big Snipe Shoot at Golden Oldie, West Virginia.
Mm-hmm.
Next Tuesday at the Fermenting Vat at Polk Belly, South Carolina. Next Wednesday and Thursday at Cousin Clyde's Ski School at Blue Cross, Tennessee. And finally, next Saturday night at Pearl's Poodle Palace, US 1 at Yap Yap, Georgia.
So long, and I won't even try to top that one.
Okay, on WWPU, the actual show on the radio was hosted by a man called Lee Moore. So the name was changed to Hootmore, and the rest is, as they say, history. The Yellow Ghost is the next one that we'll take a listen to. 1960 was the 100th anniversary of the Civil War, and as part of the hype, there was a program about John Singleton Mosby called The Gray Ghost, which ran from 1957 to 1958. And here we go.
We took our men from Texas, from the backwoods, from the mountains, the plains, from Levittown. But we lacked in number, we really lacked in brains. From north and south, they knew our fame. Yellow Ghost is what they called me. Chicken Little is my name.
The exciting adventures of the Yellow Ghost. The true stories of John Singleton Mosby, Confederate States of America. Today's exciting episode is entitled Commander of the Forces. As our story opens, we find Major Mosby and his Sergeant Miles, as the Major said.
These plans of attack I got from Richmond, Miles, look to be very complete.
The only one thing wrong, Major.
What's that?
The bridge is gone over Bull Run. We'll have to ford it.
Oh, yes.
I don't think we can afford it, Major.
I think you're right. The way you're talking today, Miles, sounds like your bridge is gone, too.
Yeah, I lost my village at Bull Run. That's the one that we've lost.
Say, Miles.
Major.
One thing before we discuss any more battle strategy. What's the morale of the men? How are the men doing?
Major, are you ready for this one?
Yes, well...
The oldest one in the business.
What's that?
Major, the men are revolting.
Now, I know that, Miles, but other than that, how are their spirits? Are they... They
well,
feel bad?
Run out of it, Major. The last supply train is...
No, I mean, are they nervous or happy or what?
They've been pretty nervous lately, Major, but I think they found something to amuse themselves.
Really? What's that?
You'll get quite a kick out of this. You're a man with a sense of humor.
Hey, what do they have?
Come on in the barracks. I'll show you.
They got something that... over the door.
See that over on the wall over there in your major?
What were they yelling and screaming about in
there? Didn't you see that picture they got hanging up on the wall?
Miles, I thought I told you before never to let pictures like that into these barracks, so this is time of war.
Major, they sent it
time...
in. I say they sent it in from Richmond. I just, the men are having
fun. Miles, you've got to go in there and get that picture off that wall and bring it in here to me at once.
It'll tear their morale down, Major.
That's too bad, Miles, but I can't afford to have things like this going on in my barracks.
Being a Confederate sergeant, I'll do my best. I salute you, Major.
Thank you, Miles.
I got myself in the eye and the finger.
Go in and get that picture, will you,
Miles? I'll go get it, Major.
I'll wait for you.
All right, you men.
Graceful, the way they yell in there. Well, Miles should be back in a minute. I'll just continue with these plans of attack here. I have no business to... Oh. Well, I noticed it's quiet in there, Miles. You must have gotten the... Oh, yes, there's the picture.
Here's the picture, Major. The men are a little...
That is disgraceful, Miles.
Don't you think it's kind of cute, Major?
That is just ridiculous. Who in the world ever heard of Robert E. Lee and Bermuda shorts?
Major...
What?
I'm surprised it's you.
Well, it is, isn't it?
No, look again at this picture.
Looks like Lee to me. Who is it, Miles?
You let the beard fool you like the men did.
Who is it?
That's Commander Edward Whitehead doing a quinine commercial there. Oh. You were just as gullible as the men were.
That beard did fool me. Both North and South, they know our fame. Yellow Ghost is what they call me. Chicken Little is my name.
Okay, how many of you remember Commander Whitehead? Okay, one of the things that we mentioned earlier was that WRC was a commercial radio station, and there were various different sponsors for the Joy Boys. One of them was Citizens Bank of Maryland, which is a large, innovative bank in the Maryland suburbs. And let's take a listen to one of their commercials.
We'll be together.
That was my orchestra, my musicians, my leadership. I commanded the whole thing. My name is Bert Kempfert, K-A-E-M-P-F-E-R-T. Remember that?
It's the longest call letter I've ever heard, Weston.
Going to be famous someday.
So that's the name of the song, Someday We'll Meet Again.
That's right.
Or we'll be together.
Play
again.
Lots of my records, please.
Bonjour, monsieur.
Bert Kempfert. Good night.
Achtung. There he goes, down the hall, up the block. Well, Walker and Scott, the Jolly Boys, still beating out the radio show of life here at the humble studios of the National Broadcasting Company here in the high atop Sin Hill here in the nation's capital. And we're delighted to have with us on the show tonight the great sponsor that's been with us now for an hour and a half. Got the ironclad clause in their contract, Citizens Banks of Maryland, right?
Oh, yeah. This is the time of year when people are coming into town, taking them on tours all around town. On your right, you'll notice the Lincoln Memorial and the statue there. Be sure to include a tour of the Beltway so you can see all 31 Citizens Bank of Maryland locations. You laugh. You scoff at me for saying that. Well, let me just tell you, there are 31 Citizens offices all over Montgomery and Prince George's and Anne Arundel County. I always have trouble with that. Thank you for hitting me there, because Anne Arundel County. And
you do the same for me.
I certainly would.
You have so my teeth, do you?
Come on over, and you can use any and all of these 31 locations as though it were your main office, regardless of where you opened your bank account. And you come on over there, and they can take care of all of your banking needs, trust funds, anything else that you have going for you. And those hours. Oh, listen, those hours. Open in the morning before work, in the evening after work, and on Saturdays up until noon. Citizens Bank and Trust Company, members of the FDIC,
And that's the Federal Deposit Insurance.
It's wonderful, Cindy. I used to be in show business myself.
You did, sir.
My wife and I were the famous Zazaloffs.
The Zazaloffs?
Yes, sir.
And you're Papa Zazaloff?
I'm Papa Zazaloff. My wife, Myrna, she's not with us tonight, though. Uh-huh. We were on the Sullivan Show 2 weeks ago.
Ed Sullivan,
on the television up in New York.
Yes, fine.
They're doing what they call sort of reminiscence night, you know?
Oh, yes.
And Grandma, she did her original act where they shot her out of a cannon.
Into a net.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
Only Annette wasn't there that night, and she went through the CBS floor.
Oh, dear.
They made her vice president, though. She landed on her head.
Okay. The next one is a local shop that a lot of people might be familiar with. Eddie Leonard, sandwich shops, long-running sponsor of the Joy Boys. They even had their own theme song.
Eddie Leonard sandwich shops, you should try them. For the very best in sandwiches, just buy them. No matter where you are, you'll find that you're not far from an Eddie Leonard sandwich shop. Every sandwich will please, 15 varieties, open late every night. You'll enjoy a tasty light, pick some up, take them home. Once you do, you'll never roam from an Eddie Leonard sandwich shop. So take that short drive for a long, large measure of sandwich and pizza pleasure at an Eddie Leonard sandwich shop. You're never far from an Eddie Leonard sandwich shop.
Amid all the hustle and bustle of Christmas shopping, we develop quite an appetite, don't we? Well, let's take care of it by stopping at an Eddie Leonard sandwich shop. Sort of saving yourself a little time in the kitchen. Have a meal on a roll. Perhaps a pizza. Perhaps a thick milkshake. Eddie's special delicious coffee. Or some hot chocolate or soft drinks. Quite a variety of those sandwiches. Quite a variety of Eddie Leonard sandwich shops, too. 9 of them all around the town. We call it class in carryout. And so will you.
Okay, the next commercial is for the Old Club Restaurant, which was located in Alexandria. It was supposedly used as a club by George Washington and James Monroe. Unfortunately, it's long gone.
From Washington, D.C., it's the Joy Boys and Living Stereophonic Sound coming your way. Please put your woofer about a half a yard from your tweeter and stand by for this. Thank you. Charlie Woofer and Mabel Tweeter, the birds and the dogs.
Son, I say, boy, which one of you and I just took time off from the Senate to come over and talk to you about a new bill that I'm introducing tomorrow?
What kind of bill is that, sir?
The bill I got at the old club the other night. I was on business. I'm going to get them to pay it.
Let me take a look at that here.
Yeah, look what I had for dinner here. It was a wonderful dinner.
Seems very reasonable. Peanut soup.
Peanut soup. We'll start with peanut soup.
Peanut soup. You got some salads for
salad,
2 cents.
Yeah, fresh salad there.
Chicken, what do they call it?
Chicken Laura Lee.
$1.90 peanuts. $25 worth of grits.
Yes, dinner's not a dinner without a mess of grits, boy.
Well, did they get you with the grits over there? Did you give the grits a fit?
I'll tell you.
Grits gave you a fit.
I just love that Southern hospitality.
Yeah.
And that little cute little waitress, she kept bringing them grits.
She's the same one that sells wallpaper to Dyer Brothers.
That's the one, yes. And I just couldn't resist her. As a matter of fact, we're being married tomorrow.
Well, isn't that romantic?
Not particularly, no.
Little hog jowls running rampant over a field of lilies, huh?
I might recommend the old club, all you people that are visiting in Washington and the folks that live here. And you know more about it than I do.
Well, I just can mention
that. You're the announcer. I'm a legislator, son.
You're actually a beast.
I'm not an announcer.
No, you're
actually, I'm an actor.
You're a very bad actor.
Give me my money, I'm leaving.
I think we've been
having
it.
Right.
Here you go.
All right, remember,
here's,
as you go through life.
Very good. There you go. Thank you very much.
The Old Spine Restaurant was located in Washington, D.C. on Connecticut Avenue. I remember listening to commercials for the Old Spine, and if you said the secret word while you were there, you got a free piece of cheesecake. Fortunately, I can't remember what the secret word was, so let's listen to the commercial.
Now, if you're in the mood for some cold beer and a knockwurst, let us go where the action is, at the Old Stein. Hey, listen to them. They're cheering, they're laughing, they're opening the beer. There goes the keg for you. Heineken's, Lohenbräu, and Michelob. We have it for you on draft here. You take your pick.
and you pay for it because we don't work on a charity basis. We're here to make a buck. And we have other goodies, too. We have Knockwurst, and we have Bratwurst, and delicious Schnitzel a la Holstein, the German potato salad. And we have sauerkraut with the hickory smoked ribs. We also have, what else you want? Alka-Seltzer?
You've
we
got a bad habit of spritzing on me when you say all
well,
those
Well, if you would move to the other side of the microphone, we speak with, what do you call it, emphasis.
That's
which
a wonderful
I heard that
show
on your station the other day, and it's very good, actually.
Let's remind you that if you want a free beer tonight, come on in the old Stein. They're having the famous Adela the Hun look-alike contest. If you look anything at all like Adela, with big horns growing out of your head and kind of a lisp and walk weird, then you'll want to come to the old Stein.
Just
forget
a moment,
that,
sir.
Yeah.
You might just win first prize. Why don't you go over? Because I
where's
think
my beer?
I think they're looking for you. It's the old Stein, 1339 Connecticut Avenue Northwest, across from the DuPont Theater, open 7 days a week.
I got a crock over there, haven't they?
Two in the morning. I think you do right here, as a matter of fact.
Free crock of cheese. It's wonderful. They get you with a beer at the old Stein.
I looked it up on Google Earth the other day. Both the DuPont Theater and the Old Stein are gone, been replaced by other buildings, unfortunately. The last commercial that we're listening to is a commercial for the Rambler. I only remember one that my brother had, and it broke down frequently, but here's the commercial for the Rambler.
Nothing like a breezy show, I always say.
While Ed Walker finds the Rambler commercial, I will tell you you're tuned to the world's largest joy boy, WRC and WRC-FM, the only show that's heard around the world.
From this station. That's it. Hey, they're here.
What? Oh.
The wonderful new Ramblers for 1961.
Good call.
Yes, sir. And by the way, your Rambler dealer has a completely new line of 1961 Ramblers. Each new Rambler carries a full year or 12,000-mile warranty, whichever comes first. Isn't that wonderful? Yes, sir. So see your Rambler dealer today.
Okay, to conclude, there's a lot more to the Joy Boys story. Bob Bybee originated the Joy Boys site, and he has allowed us to host his pages on our website. So if you go to the club's website, down there in the lower left-hand corner, you'll see a link for the Joy Boys. And you can listen to all the things that we listened to tonight and many, 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 many more. We just kind of touched the surface. There's hours and hours of very enjoyable listening. The Joy Boys holds a special place in my heart because it was what I grew up with. So that is the end. I'm sure that most of everybody was waiting for this slide. So I'm going to stop sharing my desktop, turn the meeting back to our inimitable president, Wendy Wilmer. And if anybody has any questions, I'll be more than happy to obfuscate.
Thank you very much, John. That was really excellent. Really, really fun to hear that exuberant joy from that radio program, which was really infectious in its fun. Questions, anybody, for John?
I have a bunch of them, a couple of them. How much of it was scripted and how much was it impromptu? And since Ed was blind, how did he have notes? Was it like a braille or was it like an audio recording?
And he gave an interview one time and said that his father would type up the script for the show on a braille typewriter. And Ed would be reading his braille script there as they did the show. But I'm sure there was a lot of stuff that just wasn't on the printed page.
Sure, that's a good answer. Another question is, on some of the 60s and 70s live shows, a little bit exists, and some, like Gene Shepherd, a lot does. How does the Joy Boys fit in comparison?
There are a lot of shows out there, but unfortunately, it's whatever somebody happened to record off the air, It's not like WRC or WWDC was cataloging all of this information. There are snippets of there. Sometimes there are whole shows. Sometimes there are just skits. It's not the most exhaustive, but it's still good listening.
Has anybody cataloged how much existed? In other words, built a collection or like an MP3 set or something, or tried to organize everything that exists from it?
Everything that exists is on the website. And beautiful. You can get to it by looking on our website. You can also listen to these on YouTube as well.
I have a question. It's Joni Leonard. What is your website? Judy, are you there? Can you write it down?
Yeah.
Because I'm going to be able to use the internet soon, I hope. And I want to go to your website and listen to more and more and more Joy Boys.
Okay, it's the club's website is www.MWOTRC.com/
MWOTRC.
Yeah, I've been a member of this club for years. I still can't remember what the initials are. But it's, the Metropolitan Washington Old Time Radio Club / Joy Boys. And this, the site is there. There's a lot of audio. There's a lot of video. There's pictures. A lot of interesting things to listen to.
Okay, can you repeat that again? At first you said Metropolitan, and then you said M.
Okay.
O-R, and then M-W, so I'm confused. Is it just the initials?
Yes, it's www.
Right.
MWOTRC.com/ Joy Boys.
.com/ Goodwin?
Joy Boys.
Oh, Joy Boys. Okay. Okay. www.MWOTRC.com/ Joy Boy.
Yes.
Joy Boys. Boys. Okay, great. Thank you.
If you just go to Google and type in Metropolitan Washington Old Time Radio Club, it'll take you right there.
And okay, great. I just put the website in chat for those of you who have access to the chat.
Okay, great.
In fact,
if you
tap the thing in chat, it'll take you to the website.
Thank you. Thank you so much for this evening, John. You always do such a wonderful job. Your research is super good, and thank you again. And I think that my sister and I are going to say goodnight now and take care, everyone. Happy holidays, and hope to see you in January.
Okay.
Happy holidays.
Thank you,
thanks for joining us, Joni.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Any other questions, curiosities, observations for John?
Joan?
For John Abbott, our presenter. Well, I would like to say, John, just from my point of view, you make it look very easy and very smooth. And I know that represents a tremendous amount of work.
Hi.
Well, believe me, the hardest part of putting this presentation together was figuring out what not to put into it. I mean, they did so many skits. Mr. Fix-It, for example. Anything that you could fix, they could break very easily. There are, literally dozens and dozens of skits, sometimes well-scripted. Sometimes I think they just made stuff up as they went along. And these guys were on the air together for 20-some years. And a lot of times they knew what the other one was thinking, whether they thought it or not. So, they had fun. Nobody can deny that. They had fun.
And the fun was infectious.
Yes. And for me, the interesting thing about going back and listening to these was listening to the old references about the sponsors, the restaurants, the places, you know, the names of local people and everything. It's, being an old, Washingtonian, I guess I could say, although I never lived in Washington like Edgar. So it brings back memories. And I actually did listen to the Joy Boys. So,
Wendy,
I sit back and listen.
Yes, Edgar.
Oh, I just wanted to add that I think many of the people know that it was a rarity for radio partners to actually be good friends with each other. But Willard Scott and Ed Walker were good friends their whole lives and really liked each other. And I may have mentioned before that at Ed Walker's funeral, Willard Scott was kind of the master of ceremonies, and he delivered the eulogy. And he went on for 10 minutes and had everybody in the pews rolling off their seats with laughter. And then he said, "My heart is breaking." And he went on for another 10 minutes telling funny stories. So this was a real treat tonight, John. So thank you for bringing them both back to us.
Thank you. The funeral for Ed Walker, Willard was up there, and the jokes just kept on coming. It was amazing. And they really did like each other.
Any other questions or observations? Well, John, I want to thank you again. It was a delightful evening, and I personally enjoyed it tremendously.
Well, you're going to have another opportunity in March, because I've finagled my way into giving another presentation in March.
So. I'm sure Frank Morgan will be relieved to hear that.
I've already paid off Jim Pasquale to put it on the list.
Yeah, so. You're already on the list. You're right.
I'm on a lot of lists, but
this
is the only one I really enjoy being on.
All right. So Sally has come back. She's on screen again. Sally, would you like to launch our poll results?
No.
Okay, I printed
just
it up.
Kidding.
Gotcha. All right, take it away, Sally.
All right. So I'm going to show the results of our poll here. I hope you all have your answer sheets out. Excellent, excellent. Here. Can you see it?
Holy mackerel.
Did Jack disappear? Oh. He is going to be in detention until he graduates. It is going to be, Jack. Detention for a very long time. All right. Well, it's time to go over our bookish questions. The first one was about the earliest book that spawned a radio series. When was the book David Harum first published? Looks like we were kind of split on the poll. People said maybe 1898 or 1902. One person said 1911. The correct answer goes to the letter A. 1898 is when David Harum was first published. And the earliest book other than the Bible that spawned a radio show. So there you go. Okay. Do. Number two, Stella Dallas, resulted in a Broadway play, two movies, and a radio series. Who played that title role for 18 years on NBC? I just don't even, I just hope it's not B. Benaderet, because that's just too many B's, especially because it was the letter B. Oh, Jack. But we're kind of spread all over the place here. Some people said it was Mary Jane Higby. Some said B. Some said Anne Elsner. And some said Virginia Payne. We were all over the place, but the only people who got it correct were those that picked letter C. Anne Elsner played Stella Dallas for 18 years. There you go. Good job. Number three, Mr. Keene, Tracer of Lost Persons, did a lot of things apparently in the book that he didn't do on radio, though why he didn't do them on radio is a question I would really have liked to have asked Jack. I'll find out when he's in detention. I'll make him write an essay about it. Did Mr. Keene on radio not find a lovely woman, find lovely women for Rich Bachelors to marry? Did he not have an office full of assistants? Did he not use an incantation to bring an Egyptian mummy to life? What a boring guy. Or did he not do all of those things? Well, the majority went for all of those things. And that is correct. D, all of the above. None of those happened on the radio. However, Jack does note that it's all in the novel. All of those things. So that sounds like a pretty interesting book, and now I want to read it. Number four. Frank. Now I got Frank on the brain. Frank. Frederick. Hugh Herbert, who created Meet Corliss Archer in a book of short stories, was unusual in what about the author? So this author is interesting. Which one of these answers was about the author? Was he from Austria but went to school in London? Was he a news reporter from New York that only had a high school education? Or was he a Harvard University chemistry professor? Or did he lead the efforts to find Amelia Earhart? I had no idea. Apparently we didn't either, because we all picked different ones. And the correct answer goes to two of you, who selected A. He was an Austrian-born writer who attended college in London. So there we go. There we go. I, too, was really hoping that he was a chemistry professor. Number five, about Charlie Chan. Charlie Chan was the creation of the novelist EDB, because Jack chose everyone with really obnoxious names in this quiz. And I'm starting to think he did it on purpose. Who was the last actor to play Charlie Chan at the microphone? The majority on the poll went for the person with the exuberant name, which I am going to just say Olan Soule, which sounds like a dessert. I'm not going to lie. Are they correct? Sorry. The three of you that selected Ed Begley are correct. He was the last actor to play Charlie Chan. All right, number six. The Lone Wolf, first created in a 1914 novel, became much more popular in books and movies than he was as the reformed thief on radio. Now, how did the novelist die? Any of these strange, ridiculous, seems terrible. We were kind of all over the place, though the majority thought that he probably burned to death in his easy chair while drinking and smoking. I don't know. Maybe it was that unloaded gun, everyone. know, I don't think he pulled the trigger, but let's find out. The majority wins in this one. D is the correct answer. He burned to death in his easy chair while drinking and smoking. Well, that's just grim. That is grim right there. Number seven, Fu Manchu arrived in the 1913 novel, and he was pursued on radio, on and off, from 29 to 40 by who? Nobody selected Prairie Jim and Laramie Johnson? What? That sounds like such a dynamic duo. I would totally listen to their radio program. I mean, I can hear it now. Could it have been The Shadow and Margot Lane? Well, a few of us thought so. The majority went with Nayland Smith and Dr. James Petrie. Sounds like something that's growing in a chemistry lab, too. Or could it have been Jane Sherlock and Peter Blossom? I like that name, Jane Sherlock. Let's find out who the correct duo is. Nice job, majority. You won again. Nayland Smith and Dr. James P. The Shadow and Jane Sherlock did have their own series. However, Prairie Jim and Laramie Johnson still waiting. Okay? Just saying, if anybody wants to get started on that, we could have a podcast on our hands. Number eight. Novelist Eric Hodgins wrote Mr. Blanding Builds His Dream House, and it later became a movie and a radio series with Cary Grant and who as Mrs. Blanding? Could it have been the dreaded B-B-B-B-B-B? Nobody thought so. Good job, everyone, not picking that. Let's just pretend she doesn't exist in this question. The majority went for Betsy Drake, who was an adorable one of Cary Grant's wives, the third of five. Some people selected Agnes Moorehead and Lorraine Tuttle. The correct answer is, nice job, B, the third of Grant's five wives, Betsy Drake. Jack put in a note, are you really surprised? I don't think any of us really are. Plus, she was in movies with him too, so... I mean, it all worked out. Sort of. Maybe. Okay, number nine. ABs. I take a lot of cues by approval on the screen. Thank you. ABs Irish Rose was the script of a very successful Broadway play, novel, and then it became a radio series. Only lasted for 2 years is the moral of this story, because every single chunk of time was only 2 years, but which 2 years? Everybody was all over the place here. Sometime between 1929 and 1944, the correct answer is D, 1942 to 1944. It was apparently resurrected on TV again as Bridget Loves Bernie. Who knows how successful that was? I've not heard of it. Have any of you? I see two nods. So successful? Three. I see a hand.
I'm on audio. Derek remembers it.
There's three Meredith, of you then.
Meredith Becks to Bernie and the guy that she married, David Bernie.
As long as it didn't have B, then that's fine with me. All right, number 10. Mr. and Mrs. I mean, really. Where were you when I was reading the questions? Not helpful.
Cougar. I was in the shower.
Ah, well. Yeah. Record of a happy... Excuses. He will have to retake the exam. Written by Isabel Scott Rourke. Came out in 1940, which later became My Favorite Husband on Radio, starring Lucille Ball. Now, the Cougats became the Coopers with George and George's boss and wife became regulars on the show, but who played the wife of the boss? That was a very big circle to get to the question. Who played the wife of the boss on My Favorite Husband?
What? The boss.
The wife of the boss. We were kind of all over the place, but the majority went for B. And of course, Jack had to put in a question where she was the correct answer. The correct answer is B. BB is the correct answer. So there you go. She finally gets her own. Now, it is time for the bonus. So if you didn't pass, this is your opportunity to get extra points so you don't have to stay after and take a second test. Because also, I'm not staying after and giving you a second test. You'll just fail. All right, here are the results of the, can you see them? Thumbs up, smiles, shakes of terror. Can you see the results? Oh, it stopped sharing. Yes, you can. Okay, it's gone back and forth twice, so I'm not sure what's going on.
Edgar, I'm here and I can't even see it.
He does not pass the class. The bonus question. A CBS soap opera starring Julie Stevens and Bud Collier titled Kitty Foyle was derived from a novel of the same name. Now, what was the opening line of the novel? Triple bonus points if you can name the book of each opening line. Just asking. Everyone who participated said that it was B. How interesting. Everyone who participated in this poll said it is a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a good fortune must be in want of a wife. What an interesting thing. However, I must say that is actually a Jane Austen opener.
Jane Austen.
That is from Pride and Prejudice. That is how Pride and Prejudice opens. I haven't even looked at the answer yet. I'm still on the question page. I'm just saying. Now I'm going to look at the answer. I selected the what a grand guy sometimes used to sneak in a slug of whiskey in the forenoon against doctor's orders because that just sounded hilarious, plus the other ones I knew. But I got it right. Did you get it right? The answer is C. What a grand guy. Sometimes he used to sneak a slug of whiskey in the forenoon against doctor's orders. So that is the correct answer. Now, triple bonus points. Who knows what Call Me Ishmael is from?
Moby Dick.
She raised her hand. Good job, Wendy. Other bonus points if you can tell me the author's name.
Herman Melville.
Oh, very nice. So next time I would like everyone to raise their hand and not just call out.
Oh, Lord.
How can I raise my hand if I'm on audio?
Good point, Deborah.
All right, I don't need talking back to the teacher now. All right. And the final one, it was the best of times is the worst of times.
A Tale of Two Cities.
Charles Dickens.
Oh, very nice. Very nice. Excellent job. Everyone passes the test. Everyone passes the class. Bonus points for everyone. A's all around.
That's the only reason I got the answer right is because I knew the other three the quotes. Other so it was the process of elimination.
That's exactly what I did too. Though I was very excited to see the Jane Austen quote in there. I was like, ooh, I knew. There you go. Good job, everyone.
Yes, Edgar. I'm happy.
And good
now.
Job, Sally. What good delivery. Great stuff, as always.
Everyone gets a gold star for December.
And you get Teacher of the Year for the club. We'll have to put together a new award from the club. Excellently well done. Great stuff. So I think that brings us to the end of the regular program. And we can quickly, I will stop the recording and we can dive into the business meeting. And hopefully we've already covered a lot of the stuff in that meeting. So hopefully we won't hold you much, much longer, but it's been an absolutely, I think, delightful evening. So recording is stopping right